Here we are in Orlando, Florida, and it's been a long journey to Orlando, Florida. As a matter of fact,
how'd we get here?
All right, all you babes of jazz, let's pick up the pace and let's make the parties a lot longer and make the skirts a lot shorter. And all of you, you're all going to hell in a red car.
So, and keep it hot.
Yeah, keep it damn hot.
Yeah.
And James, you're going to be the leader.
You got it.
Come on, babe, why don't we paint the town?
And all that jazz I'm gonna
Most talented people I know, Mark and Mark. Truly.
And all that jazz.
Well, I live down the street, and I've passed by this place dozens of times.
And we've heard about it through some of our friends for quite a while.
I mean, I remember from Vegas days when he used to do the lounge shows with the funny hats.
I think they're really the only entertainers in Orlando that can do what they do and that are doing what they do on a regular basis.
These two are some kind of a phenomenal thing that have not gotten all that they deserved in this business.
And all that jazz, come on, hug, we're gonna bunny hug. I got some aspirin, and at me not in shock. Please we fall apart and make a brand new start to do that jazz.
Well, if an entertainer's name is Pignoni, people might have trouble spreading the word about him. And my dad, as far as I know, has always used the name Wayne. I think that goes back to when he was in middle school.
You're walking along the street, are you having a party? Or are you alone and then you suddenly think?
I feel like I'm in Vegas.
You're someone flash, you start to realize that this could be the start.
So I had this band, which is a little six-piece band, and we played all the way through junior high and high school. I played for my own high school prom. And after high school, because I was using the name Mark Wayne at the time, then I got drafted in the Army. I went into the Army, and when I got out of the Army, came home, I decided to have some fun for a while, and I picked up a job in Nantucket, which was marvelous. Stayed there for the summer, and at that time, I got an offer to play around Boston, and so I got a trio, piano, bass, and drums, three young guys, and we're just having a lot of fun.
We worked at this club called the Mayfair. It was a Latin Quarter in Boston. The Mayfair was another big club which had a few acts. Now, sometimes people don't know this, but I wanted to get some publicity. So to get publicity, I had to buy the ad in the paper. So now we get top billing over the other six acts. So everybody think we're somebody, and we didn't have any money at all, because we were paying for the ad in the paper.
No, I never got involved in drugs as some of the other guys did. But that's one thing I didn't get involved with. So we were playing on this place one time, and the sax player on the stage, he fell off the stage. Onto the floor. He was high.
He was too high.
And he was lying on the floor playing the sax. and I yelled down. I said, "Jack it up!" You know? And he said, "Be cool, man."
So we went up to Chicago and with a trio, and we did very well. We started playing in that place, and they held us over for quite a while. And at that time, there was a lot of nightclubs in Chicago, and a lot of big ones. I saw a lot of big stars there. And this agent came in, his name was Bookie Levine, and he owned Mutual Entertainment Agency, which was a pretty good big agency. And he wanted me to sign a five-year contract with him. And I said, "I tell you what, if you give me an opening in Las Vegas, because I thought we were pretty good, then I'll sign a five-year contract." So we came back 2 weeks later and with a contract to open up for 4 weeks in Las Vegas. I signed a 5-year contract.
Every lounge, every casino, I should say, had lounge shows. They'd do like 45 minutes and they would change every hour. I mean, you had, like 3 and 4 groups working 24 hours a day. Well, not 24, but, you know, whatever they did. They'd do 3 and 4 sets. And the biggest thing you could name in the business. And Mark was one of those with his group.
The big hotels in Vegas weren't there at that time. There were the Sands, and the last hotel on the Strip was the Tropicana. And that's when Frank Sinatra and all the Rat Pack guys were hanging around. And Frank was sort of the king of Vegas at the time, him and Dean Martin and Sammy Davis Jr. And of course, and the lounges in those days would go from 12 at night to 6 in the morning. And you might, if you went to the lounge of the Sahara, in the audience could be Sammy Davis Jr. Or maybe even Frank would hang around the lounge of the Sands sometime, you know. Now, after spending a few years here, I had my band, and I'd ask the drummer, how much do you owe? And he'd be down $2,000. The bass player would be down $3,000. I'd be down, because they would give us advances easily. Just say, give me $500, and they'd give it to you. But sometimes, and we weren't the only ones. A lot of entertainers were behind for a month or two, even big stars, because they would just give you them, they'd give you advances. So after being in Vegas a few years, and none of us had any money because we gambled and we drank and saw shows, I told Boogie to get us out of here. We worked a couple of places, then we went to the Space Coast. And we were the first, you might say, major group to hit the Space Coast at the time. Cocoa Beach was really in the boondocks.
Now, if you want, you can snap your finger and help her up. I can't snap too good.
He's Italian, that's why.
Hey. Never knew how much I loved you. Never knew how much I cared. When you put your arms around me, I get a fever that's hard to bear. You give me fever when you kiss me, fever when you hold me tight, fever in the morning, fever all through the night.
So whereas my group was smashing at that time, I got an offer to take over the Cocoa Motel. And so I thought it would be great. We took over the motel, and we were still working 6 nights a week, plus I'd have to get up at 9 a.m. to run a restaurant and book parties and everything else. And since we had a big room, I was able to, through my contacts in show business, to bring in some big names, relatively reasonable. And I brought in the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra, I brought in Cy Zettner's Orchestra, I brought in Frank Sinatra Jr. At the time, I brought in Dave Brubeck, which I think was around one of the times when John Glenn was going to go around. NASA asked me to handle his coming home. And so I catered that, and I brought in one of his friends from the service, Woody Woodbury, and Woody emceed the event, and the whole 7 astronauts were there with their wives, and we had a big party that time.
Surely, baby, you're my flame. Thou givest fever when you kiss it, fever with your flame in you. Fever, you're on fire. Fever, I burn for soon.
Well, my mother was in a beauty contest, and I think she was in 2 beauty contests, actually, and my father was a judge. I think one of them was in Cocoa Beach. This is in the early 70s, I guess. My father was somewhat of a local celebrity, I think, at the time.
That's the contest I was in, Sunrise Cover Girl, that I met Mark. He's just in a caricature.
There's the Today newspaper. Mm-hmm. And they made me a judge. And I judged all these girls. And I picked that one.
That's me, in the orange bikini.
So I asked, my question was, well, who's your favorite entertainer? Okay? And the one girl could say maybe the Rolling Stones, you know.
Mick Jagger was a big deal.
And sort of go along. And then they're all
they
that type.
They thought Mick Jagger was an entertainer.
Yeah.
They didn't know.
Then I come up to this other girl, and I said, well, who's your favorite entertainer? And she said, Frank Sinatra, which was very interesting.
He looked at me very strange.
For a young girl to like Frank.
What?
Really, no kidding, that's interesting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. She didn't go for the normal rock people that were going at the time, you know.
But you said entertainer, you didn't say rock musicians. I mean, that's different.
Whatever it was, And it happened to be Lorna. Okay, so that's nice, you know. So that first year in the contest, the contest was over, then we voted. She did not win the first year. I voted for her.
We were in the top five.
Two voted for somebody else.
Right.
All right, so that was it.
I was 16.
16 at the time.
Yeah.
And so there was no romantic interest at that point. You know,
not on your part.
All right.
That might have been on mine, but not your side. So then a couple of years went by, we became friends. He would call me on the phone and we would talk.
Well, you were singing with a group.
And I came in and sang with your group some. I had never sung in a nightclub before, and he was going to help me get started to be a singer. I told him I wanted to be a singer since I was a child. So I went in and I sang a few things with the group, and it was pretty scary, I must admit. Because all of them knew what they were doing, and I didn't have any idea what I was doing.
We didn't really have much of a date. He called me on the phone a lot. When we met for lunch one day, after we had talked on the phone forever, he talked every day, called every day, we talked. And it was a situation at that point where I wouldn't go out with him anyway. Because he was just about to be married to somebody. So anyway, it's kind of a mess. Anyway, so I'm talking to him on the phone, and he said, well, meet me for lunch. I said, okay. And there was a place called Lums at that point, years ago, over in Melbourne. I said, okay, I'll meet you, Lums. And I go into this Lums, and all the waitresses are giggling. And I'm thinking, wait a minute, what are they? They're giggling. And over in the corner, he's got this table, and he has a light on it. It has a light bulb. It's about this big. And in the inside of the bulb is a heart. It says, I love you in the heart. And it's got a stuffed animal there, and it's got a bunch of presents on the table. And that's what all the girls were giggling about, you know. They knew who I was when I walked in. So I went over and sat down with him at that table. So, but I mean, I knew from the minute that we met, and so it took a little while to straighten things out, but we didn't really have hardly any dates. In fact, he asked me to marry him on the phone. On the phone, can you believe it? He says, the phone rang, my mother picked up the phone, and she didn't know what was going on. She says, it's Mark Wayne on the phone. I said, oh, okay. And so I said, hello? And he says, now, when I get divorced, will you marry me? I said, well, I'll tell you next week. So I hung up the phone. My mother says, what did he want? I said, he wanted to marry me. She said, what? On the phone? I said, yeah, on the phone. So he was working in Lakeland. He got everything else straightened up. We went to Lakeland that night. I went with a girlfriend. I sat in the front row, and he was on stage. And they had at that point, they were doing like a comedy type of thing. It was four guys, and they were doing skits and all kinds of comedy, novelty songs, and then they would go into dance music after that was over. So they were up there doing dance music by the time I got in there. And he waved when I came in. I sat in the front row, and I just looked at him and went like that. He got the front row. So that's how I told him that we were getting married.
All right, here's one by Barry Manilow. Manilow.
So we were working in Cocoa Beach with a pretty large group. And
Johnny Esposito's place.
Yeah, and we got an offer to go to Houston. And so we packed up everything and we went out to Houston and we played in Houston. And that the owner of the big, it was a big nightclub, seated 900 people.
Huge.
At the end of the engagement, instead of paying me what he was supposed to pay me, he only gave me like 1/4 of what he's supposed to give me.
Right.
And when we had finished, and when he paid me, he said, "That's all you're going to get." And at that time, he opened up his drawer and he had a gun there. And I looked at the money and I looked at him.
So
I took the money and here I am in Houston, and our next job was in LA, and that didn't open up for a week or so.
Right.
And I had 10 guys to take care of. So I did a thing. I went down to the musicians union. We used to have a union, and went down to union. I told the union, "I can't hang around here with all these guys. So I'll tell you what, I'll file a claim against the owner, and anything that we get, I'll donate half of it back to the union."
And we got nothing.
And so,
so they did absolutely nothing.
So then we went to LA,
Los Angeles,
for a brand new nightclub out there.
Right.
And they weren't ready to open up yet for construction.
Yeah.
So we had to hang around there for a week. So that was this is sort of a disastrous time.
Pretty big mess.
It was a pretty big mess. So then we opened.
And then you fell.
Well,
remember
in the hotel,
that?
Yeah.
He fell in the hotel,
yeah.
Hit his back really badly, and I had to take him to the hospital. They gave him a shot, and when they gave him the shot, I thought it was just going to get rid of the pain, but it knocked him totally out. So I'm getting ready for work that night, which I had been singing for about 3 or 4 months at this point, and I had to leave the band. So that was a real panic situation, because he was totally knocked out, laying in the hotel room, out. So. After, and then we went through all that, and then went back to Atlanta.
Yeah, right after that, we had the same thing happened in LA. The owner there was shorting me money also.
Oh yeah.
So we junked the big group, 10 people, and we came back in. We got about a 5 or 6 piece group,
mm-hmm.
and we went to Atlanta, Georgia.
And then I started getting sick.
Yeah, she don't know why though.
Feeling sick, and I was getting sick at night, which was very strange. And finally, I said, "I think maybe I'm pregnant." So, had a test in Atlanta. And I'm pregnant. Oh, well. See, I was kind of upside down with my time, because we would work until like 2 or 3 in the morning. So then we'd have breakfast, and then we'd go to bed. And when I woke up, it was the evening. So when I woke up is when I had the morning sickness, but it wasn't actually in the morning. So we came home and said, "We're going to do a duo from now on." And we're going to raise our child in Orlando, where we have a nice home, and not take the baby on the road with us.
The business was changing then. Traveling groups were becoming, there weren't that much. It was getting less and less of traveling groups playing. There used to be a lot of places, then it became less. So we became a duo, and we came back to Orlando, and we've been staying here ever since.
Right. And you're gonna be.
Marco was musical from the time he was really little. I would have him on my lap and there would be music on, and from, I'd say, around a year old, he had rhythm. He would clap his hands right in the rhythm, you know, with the music. You didn't have to really teach him that, he already had that. And he loved music so much, we gave him piano lessons, and then he took dancing lessons, he took jazz and tap. Jungle. He actually taught himself how to juggle. That summer we went to New York, because we thought he needs to go to Broadway shows. So we took him to Broadway shows, and we started going around New York, and he kept these juggling balls with him everywhere he went. And so we went to Macy's, and he's standing outside of Macy's, and he says, "Daddy, take a picture of me juggling outside of Macy's." So he took a picture.
Then we went to the Empire State Building. Take a picture of me juggling on top of the Empire State Building. So everywhere we went, we have pictures of Marco juggling.
And in New York, you can do whatever you want on a street. Nobody pays attention.
No.
Okay, that's all. All right, go ahead. Are we on?
Yeah.
Go ahead. Keep going. And here he is, Marco the juggler. Okay, now I want your daddy to show you how to do it right. I want daddy to show you how to do it right. You ready?
So after Marco was born, when he was 5 weeks old, we started doing a duo, and then we did four pieces, some places five pieces, but mostly we decided a duo was the best thing for us. We had plenty of jobs as a duo, more than you would with a large group. That's just how the economy was going at that point and how the show business was going. So we came to this place in 1991, and this is the Red Fox Lounge.
There's a lot of different walks of people, ages of people here, and Mark and Lorna are so welcoming. You know, we walk in and they greet us by name, and I don't feel out of place at all. It reminds me of an age that I have never, that I shouldn't really know anything about. I mean, chronologically speaking, but you know, from the movies or whatever, like it's very romantic, old. I don't know, dusky old bar. They invoke some feeling of nostalgia or something. I don't know. They're wonderful.
I've got you under my skin. I've got you deep in the heart of me. You're so deep in my heart. You're really a part of me. And I've got you under my skin.
So Marco's little and we're here in Orlando. Had very good friends, Walt Stewart and Barbara Stewart. Walt Stewart has recently passed away. He was an excellent arranger and musician who arranged.
Not only locally, but nationally.
He arranged for The Tonight Show, for Barbara Streisand, okay, for Judy Garland, and everybody. His wife was a singer. And we got to know them really well, and Barbara and I were really best friends, good friends. Before she got really sick, she said, Lorna, I can't teach anymore. I've got all these students, and you're the only other one I can think of that can teach them what they're looking for, which was more of a voice production and singing pop music, rock music, not the classical that you normally get with a voice, but the practical end of it, so you can really work. So I said, okay, I'll take some of your students. And that's how I started teaching voice, was because of her.
You know, we started coming into the Red Fox Lounge a number of years, probably 12 years ago or more, and we loved the music. Mark and Lorna play just about any kind of song you'd want to hear. My wife gave me some singing lessons after we had met them, and that was about 12 years ago.
A, B, C, D.
Straight toe. Yeah, vibrato. Okay, one more.
A, B, C, D.
Thank you.
after teaching all these students every week and working 4 hours a night, five, six nights a week, singing about 50, 60 songs a night. So I started getting a hoarseness problem. When I went to the voice doctor, he also told me it could be a silent reflux, which is an acid reflux, and a lot of people have acid reflux problems. Well, this causes hoarseness.
I haven't tried, actually, to do much as far as doing any songs that have a high range since then, anyway, because I wanted to come in here and first see if I had, you know, done any permanent damage before I did something like that.
Well, let's take a little look at your vocal cords. Now, glissando up. Now. And for the very highest notes, you're using way up here, then you're using just this little edge right here. And guess what's in the middle of this edge? That's where the problem is. See the swelling right in here?
Sure.
A little bit of stiffness.
I figured out, though, that I could do maybe 24 hours of silence a week, and that would really help my voice totally. And I talked to a lot of other singers that had a lot more trouble than I did, and mine actually, the doctor even told me, he said, I'm surprised it didn't hit you way before this because you've been singing so much that normally you'd sing around 2 hours a night is plenty to sing. And I'm singing twice that much and then teaching in the day, and it was just too much, way too much. So the voice teacher I went to, he gave me all these pamphlets and all these things, and I learned how to help myself. But then I started having stomach problems, a lot of stomach problems.
That's a hard question. I don't know what the hell my reaction was. When I found out she had cancer.
I was on the phone at home and with someone, and I got beeped in, and it was this hysterical person calling regarding a colonoscopy, and I think, is this Mark? And yeah, he was absolutely beside himself. He was just so upset, crying, very, very, very scared, very concerned about Lorna.
Well, you know, when the doctor looked at her x-rays, and then he turned to me and he said, yeah, that's definitely cancer, which wasn't a nice thing to hear right away, you know, but he was pretty sure what it was. And now that was one doctor. But we got another doctor's opinion, and the second doctor said that it was cancer, but he can take care of it. And so it's a very, you just don't know where to go with that. You just have to go ahead and do what you have to do. And Lorna was actually very brave. You find out what it was. Okay, we have to operate. Good, when? Let's do it right away and get it over with, you know.
So I had chemotherapy, and it was not much fun. By the time I had the fifth one, which I had them on Mondays because that was my night off. I had it on a Monday, and by Thursday of that week, I woke up 3 o'clock in the morning after working Thursday night, actually, with pain in my stomach that was double over, screaming, crying type pain. I hadn't even had that with the cancer, so that was scary. At first I thought, oh, the cancer came back. I didn't know what had happened. I called my mother and said, I think you better come over here because I'm going to have to go to the hospital and Mark needs to go to work the next night by himself. So my mother came over, went to the emergency room, and I sat in the emergency room for 10 hours and I was vomiting blood and all kinds of horrible things. So, and doubled over with pain. So as soon as I got in there, I was there about midnight. And my doctor ordered another CT scan. So they got me out of the room and took me back down to take the CT scan. This is at midnight. And I had the CT. And as I was having it, when they pulled me out and I was finished, my surgeon was standing there. And I said, what are you doing here at midnight? And he said, well, they informed me that you were here. And I wanted to read the CT to make sure I didn't miss anything. And he looked at me right then. He said, I looked at it, and there's no cancer there. It's the chemo causing all your problems. So my doctor, my oncologist said, well, you can't have any more chemo, because I ended up being in the hospital for almost a week and really having horrible pain. Couldn't digest anything, even cream of wheat or Jell-O. I couldn't digest anything. So he told me, the strange thing is, he said, you have internalized all this, that it's unusual. Normally people lose their hair and vomit and get sores in their mouth, sores on their hands. I got none of that, but it internalized with me, and it just really made me sick internally. Then I started having more trouble with acid reflux, and I think it was because of the chemo. I'm not sure, but it seems like I had a lot more trouble with that. So anyway, that was 3 years and 9 months ago, and I've had several other CT scans, and I've had a couple other colonoscopies, and everything has been perfectly fine. I've had no reoccurrence of anything so far. So I feel very blessed that has happened, and it's been good for Mark, of course, because he was frantic when I was sick. And him being older than me, he thought he was gonna be the one that was gonna get sick and not me. And he went to work without me, and when I was in the hospital, I told him, you stay away from the hospital. Because when he would look at me, I thought, he can't even take it. He can't even look at me laying here in bed. So I just told my mom, I said, you stay with me to the hospital. Tell him to go to work.
It's always been amazing to me that two people that are in this business, in show business, can get along 24 hours a day, because they not only work together, they live together, they vacation together, they do everything together. They're like joined at the hip. I don't know what Mark would do without Lorna. I really don't. I don't know what Lorna would do without Mark.
If we would, one of us get to the point where we can't work, then I think, if it was me, I think Mark would keep working. I'm not sure whether we keep working at the Red Fox, but I think he would keep working. I think he'll play the piano as long as someone will pay him. He'll play the piano.
Yeah, I don't know what he'd do if anything ever happened to her, you know. I think Mark might retire. I think he might just hang it up if she would, if anything happened to her.
Open wide and help me.
When you're an entertainer, there's a lot of trials and tribulations and problems that you come across as you're going through it, okay? Now, when people go and see someone on a stage, they see them do their 45 minutes or whatnot, whether they're singing and dancing, and have no idea of what's going on in their head or their lives. Michael Jackson's a good idea. Say, there's a lot of turmoil going on sometimes. But as a performer, when the bell rings, you go out there and you bang it out as good as you can. So the thing is, same thing like with Lorna and I, when she had some problems even with her voice, the audience had no idea that we were skating on thin ice, and you know, while we're doing the show, just hoping to get through that particular night, or the next night, and the next night. And you just have to keep going. If that's all, like right now, this is all I've ever done, you might say. And so regardless of what happens, I would still have to do what I'm doing, you know. And I think Lorna, if you break an arm, you still go on and perform. See, for some reason performers, they go on a lot of times with, you could have a loved one die in the afternoon. When you go on at night, you do your show and you just don't show it.
Stop.
once you travel around the country, which I did with a couple of bands, and you go from California to Boston to Chicago to Miami, back to California, back to Las Vegas, Reno, Tahoe, and then all the other big cities in between, like Fargo, North Dakota, or LaSalle, Illinois, or Decatur, or Montpelier, Indiana. Now, you do that a lot, and pretty soon you find out that the city really doesn't matter anymore. All hotel rooms begin to look alike. You don't even know what city you're in sometimes.
He's a showman in a lounge. I mean, he knows how to work the crowds. He knows how to gather people. You know, he knows how to the warmth, and that's where it's at. If you don't talk to the people, if you don't play to the people, then you're out of it.
A whole new audience has come in the last few years. In fact, since I've left Orlando, and so when I go back, I always see. I'm shocked at the audience. They've got a new audience, and some of them are younger than me, surprisingly. So they've had a lot more fun over the last few years. And neither of them has given me any indication that they would want to quit anytime now. They have so much fun going, and they see a lot of young people that really enjoy the music. And I think they can see that they're adding a lot to a number of people's lives, and new people. And they see new people all the time. And their audience continues to grow, and it's just, it's exciting, I think.
The music that was popular between, let's say, the ages of 12 and 21, when you were between 12 and 21, is the music you're going to love for the rest of your life.
They're a wonderful couple, and they have beat all the odds of being a couple.
And we have a wonderful audience that comes in, and the reaction between us and the audience is a love affair, okay? Which a lot of people don't have love affairs. And we have that between the two of us and also with the audience. And we receive that back from them, you know. It's got nothing to do with money or glamour or anything else. It's that moment that when we go in there and we do something and the audience explodes. Okay, you can live your life like that. And a lot of performers, even guys who make tons of money, you wonder, why don't they quit? Because you don't quit. You need, I don't know if you need it, but you like the idea of performing in front of an audience and getting the feedback, you know. And whether you're making $90 a week or $9,000 a week or something, it's got nothing to do with it, you know.
That girl got more energy than I've ever known for crying out loud.
I tell you.
The whole night through.
Oh.